BFBS London.
Jonathan Staples reporting after a night that seen thousands of East Germans flood across the Berlin Wall.
One man just come through, raised his arms in the air and declared, I've made it, I've made it. Your first time in West Berlin?
First time, yes.
So why have you come? Just want to visit? You're here to visit?
Yes, I go back, of course.
But what do you think about this evening?
I think it is a very, very important day.
Fantastic.
Wonderful.
We'll be devoting this edition to the story of the decade after a brief summary of today's other news.
The Minister of Agriculture, John Gummer, has said he thinks his department has traced virtually all the farms which may have used cattle feed contaminated with lead. The total of farms where restrictions on the movement of milk and dairy products have been imposed is now about 1,300. Police in Belfast are investigating the death of an officer in a shooting incident last night in the north of the city. It's thought he was accidentally hit by a colleague who opened fire during an undercover surveillance operation. And doctors have warned that the shortage of donor organs, particularly kidneys and liver, for transplants is worsening.
I remember when the wall was built, I was a man, 21, and I see people jumping from the eastern side to the western side, and they were killed in this time. And now changes, they come to us without danger and free.
There was dancing in the streets of Berlin last night as thousands of East Germans flooded across the Berlin Wall. For the first time in almost 30 years, they were allowed across after travel restrictions were suddenly lifted. Many just went over to have a look before crossing back home. Others were reunited with their families. Graham Leach was at Checkpoint Charlie at midnight.
From either side of the Berlin Wall now, people, East Germans and West Germans, are waving to each other. Not since the Berlin Wall went up in August 1961 has this border crossing witnessed such scenes. The police commander on duty here at Checkpoint Charlie has suddenly announced that they can go over, even though they may not have the right documents, and they're simply charging now through the small gate in the fence where they're queuing up to get across to the western side of the Berlin Wall. I've now reached the western side of Checkpoint Charlie, where there are a huge number of people here waiting to greet the first of the East German arrivals. The first East German has come across now. He's been raised aloft. He's holding up his identity pass, his East German identity pass, to show the crowds of West Berliners who've gathered here tonight. I'm being showered in champagne by somebody above me who's literally sitting on one of the border fences. Among the West Berliners who've gathered on the Checkpoint Charlie crossing point. We want to get across too. We want to get across too, they're chanting. More and more coming through now. Each of them being embraced by the West Berliners who have come here to welcome them. An East German police officer has now stood on top of one of the gates trying to calm the crowd. He's having no success whatsoever. One man's just come through, raised his arms in the air and declared, I've made it, I've made it.
Graham Leach reporting from the Berlin Wall last night. Well, joining me now is Werner Sabiers, himself a Berliner and a German correspondent working in London. Obviously very emotional scenes. What do last night's events in Berlin mean to you as a native Berliner?
Well, I think it's tremendous news for any Berliner in any case, you see, and it's hard not to get emotional about it. I was born in Berlin. I grew up in Berlin. I was in Berlin in 1961 when the wall came up. I have seen how families have been divided. And there was a dream on both sides of the wall all the years, one day it might be possible again that families, that friends can come together without this kind of bureaucracy. And we see this now. It means, of course, really for every Berliner, if you put enough pressure on, you can get changes. And it shows simply that the East Germans really have their authorities on the run.
Now, numerous commentators and observers have been telling us that now, to all intents and purposes, the Berlin Wall is redundant. Is that true?
I don't think it's redundant yet. Of course, it will be redundant in this way, trying to stop people to leaving for the West. But there are other areas where the East Germans probably think it might be necessary to keep it. First of all, having certain border controls, controlling here some kind of a movement, as at any international border. Maybe, as I might say, at the other hand, for economic reasons as well, for preventing strongly subsidized East German goods just being taken over to the West. I don't think they will decide immediately to pull the wall down, but for every purpose in the political sense, stop people moving to the West. In this way, the wall is redundant.
Will there now be free movement between the divided sectors by everyone?
We think more or less this will be the case. I have published the new travel law. The restrictions have been taken away. People can move over from one side of the city to the others. We think, yes, we will get back to the situation as it was before 1961 when the Berlin Wall was built.
Now, the danger after the initial euphoria, certainly in West Germany, is perhaps a change of mood brought about by pressure on jobs and housing by tens of thousands of East Germans flooding in, not only at the moment, but as they have been for some weeks by making use of third countries as crossing points. That change of mood, is it likely to come?
Well, we have to see first. Of course, the West German government told the East German population, please stay at home, try to reform the country from within, what they are more or less probably might be more inclined to do now since they have no longer this kind of travel restriction. I assume that the number of refugees which are coming over to the West will decline quite dramatically for the simple reason there is no longer the feeling I can't get out anymore. If they want to go at a later time, they will. And what we have seen already now, all those East Berliners today flooding into West Berlin, they didn't bring any luggage with them. They came over to look. And they will, of course, most of them, in any case, will go back again.
Werner, I'll come back to you shortly. Watching the extraordinary scenes overnight in Berlin have been the Royal Military Police. Captain Ross Mackay was on duty all night. He told Chris Russell from British Sector Headquarters what these thousands of East Germans looked like as they crossed the border.
Very happy. Travelling across initially in vehicles, but it got to the stage that the crowds on foot were so huge that vehicle travel between the points was impossible. So cars were abandoned on the other side and people began walking through. There were West Germans greeting them with flowers, with champagne, open arms, a very, very happy, very carnival-type atmosphere.
What were your orders as far as checking these people through was concerned?
Well, obviously, that's not a military responsibility. That's the civilian side. And initially, they were being allowed through. At the start, visas were being checked, obviously, by the East Germans, but with the size and the number of people, it just appeared that they were streaming through without checks and coming into to the West. Initially, after midnight, there was a large number, a great band of people coming through. That gradually died down as the morning wore on. And then in the later part of the morning, 4 or 5 o'clock, scores of people returning back into East Berlin. Currently, we're probably back to a state of what could be described as normality, with people coming and going with relative ease. And as yet, we haven't had any repetition of the scenes of midnight of last night.
We saw on television the most extraordinary scenes of people standing on the wall. Did you see that?
Yes, indeed. There have been scenes like that. In fact, Brandenburg Gate, the wall at that location, was 3 or 4 deep in West Berliners and indeed East Berliners, hand in hand.
Is this going to change the way that the Royal Military Police operate? I mean, presumably, if there's no more wall, there are no more wall patrols.
That I don't know. All I can say is that currently we are carrying on as normal.
Is this the beginning of the end of an era, do you think?
I think it's more than a flash in the pan. If you could experience the scenes last night, it could probably be the start of change. But as to what? Who knows?
Captain Ross Mackay of the Royal Military Police. Well, coming back to Werner Sabiers, the London-based German correspondent, Berlin has been occupied, if you like, or protected by four powers, Britain, France and the USA and the Soviet Union since the end of World War II. What now for the future of the city as a four-power city?
Well, we don't really think so. are necessarily to be greater changes in this. Berlin always has been a four-power city, and it is, of course, up to negotiation what is going to happen in the future. But I think altogether that the West German government and the West Berlin authorities, and probably the East Berlin authorities as well, will come to some kind of an arrangement which would not change Berlin as a four-power city, but which probably would lead to some kind of troop reduction.
Well, in the United States, there's been a very warm welcome from Republicans and Democrats alike for the East German authorities' decision to remove all the impediments to travel for their citizens. David McNeil now reports from Washington.
The news from East Germany was exactly what senators and congressmen wanted to hear. Senator George Mitchell, the leader of the Democrats in the Senate, interrupted proceedings in the chamber to read a statement on behalf of his party.
Today's decision, not an act of democracy, not an act to please or placate the West, but a desperate act of survival by the East German government to permit their people to leave, represents the symbolic destruction of the Berlin Wall.
Senator Sam Nunn, chairman of the Armed Services Committee, said the pace of change was overwhelming. It was like being fed through the nozzle of a fire hose. Senator Nunn said it was a time of great hope, but also of some concern. If free elections proposed by the communist government resulted in the election of a non-communist regime, would those now in power accept it?
We also have to ask the question, what is the Soviet Union's bottom line? Mr. Gorbachev has tolerated things in the last year that caused the Soviet Union to invade in 1956 Hungary and in 1968 Czechoslovakia. So it seems that the spokesman for the Soviet Union today said perhaps the bottom line was the Warsaw Pact membership. We have to ask the question, what if that freely elected government, if and when it happens, and we pray that it does, decides they don't want to be part of the Warsaw Pact?
And the senator said it was now time for men of vision to step forward, to shape the kind of Europe that was going to emerge.
This means that the common market, I believe, has to be a little different instrument than was envisioned as recently as several months ago. It has to open itself up to trade with the East in a way that gives these regimes and opportunities to make progress economically. That's going to be, I think, a key.
Well, let's come back now to my guest, Werner Sabiers. The rest of Europe and the world looks on. There have been some worries expressed, particularly from France, that the rapidly changing situation in East Germany might mean that the West Germans might turn eastwards, as it were, and be tempted to concentrate more on a reunified Germany than continue to play a pivotal role in the European community. Do you think those fears are ill-founded or well-founded?
I don't think that those fears are well-founded. We have to take into consideration that the West German government again and again, and just now, yesterday again, it was said in the Bundestag, it was made quite plain that reunification of Germany remains a major aim, but it has to take place within the framework of Europe. In other words, Germany has no intention whatsoever to move away from the European community, to move towards the East. But it does not mean, at the other hand, that the one thing might rule the other out. It means we think reunification, if it comes by self-determination of the people, and of course we have to ask the East German people here as well if they want it, if reunification comes about, that would not in any way alter the situation that West Germany as such will remain integrated, or United Germany will be integrated in certain setups as we have it in the European community, for instance.
Now, it's only a few weeks ago that Mr. Gorbachev was in East Berlin, and Erich Honecker seemed at the time quite determined to maintain the very rigid status quo. Why has there been such an incredible acceleration of the pace of change since then?
Well, I think the East German authorities simply have been forced by their own population to move, and we know from certain sources that the Soviet Union thought the situation in East Germany as it was going on can't go on as it was. There must be changes, that there was indirect some pressure. And of course, one found a new leader, Egon Krenz. He himself was a hardliner, but he now seems to prove to the population in East Berlin that he is prepared to move if there's enough pressure. And the people in the country for the first time have seen that they have power. They are no longer afraid of the state authorities. And I think this pressure, it was this pressure which really got things moving.
Werner Sabiers, thank you very much for joining me. You've been listening to News Plus with Jonathan Staples. Today's producer, Colin Hamilton.